Okay. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
So who is a guest here? Do we have any guests? Okay. We have a few. Well, you're not really a guest. Come on. Okay. So welcome to the first in 2017 graduation product demos. We're here to view the amazing work of the Jackrabbits 2017. Let's give them a round of applause. So for those of you who are new to this space, we are Dev Bootcamp. We are the original web development immersion program. And what that means is we take complete beginners and turn them into full stack web developers over a course of an 18-week period. Now, we like to end this 18-week program with the final project, which really serves as a culmination of all the skills they learn up until this point. Now, to give you some context, these projects were started just on Thursday. So they had about a week to complete the amazing things that they've been able to complete. Now, this particular cohort is very near and dear to me because I was able to see them from the very beginning and kind of see them grow from a place of an experience, a place of like a bit of inconfidence in terms of their own abilities to where they are now. And the projects that you're about to see are no doubtedly going to blow your mind. And I could not be more proud of the beautiful and meaningful things they're going to show you. So let's start with the first group. So this first group is very special because what they're doing is they're combining virtual reality technology and redefining physical therapy. So without further ado, I'd like to present you VHab.
Welcome everyone. I'm gonna tell you a story. Like a year ago, one of my friends, she had a really bad car accident, and after that she lost all her hand functions since the accident is too bad. And I saw her went through all the physical therapies the whole way. It takes such a long time and it's repetitive and it can be really expensive. You have to do that in the clinic. So at that time I was thinking there should be a better solution to make the hand rehab a more affordable and more engaging experience for people of all ages, either in the clinic or just at their home. So that's the reason why we are making this app. Our app's name is VHab. VHab is a VR game for hand rehabilitation. With using the leg motions tracking technology, we'll be able to capture all the hand motions of the users and enable the users to interact with all the elements on the screen. So VHab is simple and fun to play with. It trains your finger strength and hand strength so that users can practice their hand functions while playing the games. So people always talk about make this world a better place. With technology, you can really do it. The next, Natalie will show you how this whole thing works.
The leap motion sensor is a device that allows you to interact directly with your computer without using a mouse or a touch screen, simply by making hand gestures. When the user places their hands within the sensor's range, a hand visualization appears on the screen.
This is all part of the presentation.
There we go. So we've created 5 categories of exercises and games designed to increase muscle strength, increase coordination, and reduce muscle stiffness. The first 3 are just basic repetitive motions like pinching, finger stretch, and grabbing motions that the user can do a number of times. And Jessie's going to demonstrate grab for you right now. And as you can see on the screen, the user can create a grab-like motion, and the visualization will appear on the screen with motivational, encouraging messages for the user.
You are doing well.
And when Jessie completes 5, does this for 5 times,
you are
a button
so
will
close.
Appear to be directed back home.
Great, you hit it.
And the last 2 games are a little bit more complicated and involve more coordination. We have whack-a-mole, which Jessie will demonstrate now. And the purpose of this game is to hit the bunny 5 times without hitting the tiger. Anytime you hit the tiger, you lose a life. You lose 2 life. If you lose all your lives, the game ends. And this is just great for coordination and arm strength. And as you can see, it's more difficult to perform than the other exercises. And the last game is a pinch and drag motion. And the user's hand is represented by the sphere on the screen. The purpose is to move all of the spheres on the left-hand side to the right-hand side. When the user has their hand above the sphere, it changes color. And once all the spheres have been moved over, the game redirects back home. And now Albert will talk about the technologies we use to create this.
Thank you, Natalie. Okay, first we start with the leap motion controller. That's the device that Jessie showed you before. What that does is simply record the location of your hand at any given moment and sends that data to our application. Next, we use a library which comes with the Leap controller. It's called Leap.js. What that does is it's able to find patterns in this data which detect motion and different gestures. With that, we can do 2 things. First, we are able to listen to the user's gestures, meaning that when a user successfully performs a gesture, we can give them feedback on their progress. Second, using the data that the Leap Motion Controller sends, we can make visualizations of those hands on screen, meaning we can render it like any other 3JS object. So to render this hand, we used another library called 3JS. What that does is it renders objects onto the screen, or 3D objects onto the screen. And this is basically the way it works. So you create like the face of your object, which is the image, the texture, the material, basically what it's going to look like. Second, you create the shape of your object, which includes geometry, vertex, and base 3. Those 2 combine to create your so-called mesh, which is your 3D object, and combined with the lighting and the camera positioning, this object gets put into the scene, and then it constantly gets rendered. And to discuss the obstacles of our project, I'm gonna hand it over to Jenna.
Thanks, Albert. Okay. So the first obstacle that we faced when it comes to creating this project is normally Dev Bootcamp teaches us things like Ruby, Rails, React, and JavaScript, but those particular aspects were not going to serve our purpose for this particular project with what we had in mind. So we set off on our own and started exploring a lot of different new technologies that we didn't learn at Dev Bootcamp. We were confident we could learn whatever we set out to do because of the skills that we learned at DBC, so we spent a lot of time investigating these. And then we finally settled on three different libraries that we were going to use, which included a physics engine, which is PhysiJS, the 3JS library, which is the 3D library that we use to render all those images, and then the Leap Motion controller. We did face quite a few problems. The original idea for this particular game was to include a level that had block stacking, so that's why the physics engine was needed, so that the blocks performed the way that the user anticipated. However, the technologies that we used did not mesh together, so we had to change tactics and redefine what we wanted this project to look like. So once we finally settled on the technologies that we were going to use, we settled on these five. We used 3JS 3X, which is an extension of the 3JS library, HTML, JavaScript, and then your usual jQuery to see all of the sounds, all of the music, and then all those gestures that you see on screen. And then once we were able to do that, we were able to think about where do we go from here? And what we would likely do in the future would be to explore Unity a little bit more. Unity is something that allows you to use all of the technologies that we were going to, but in a nice compact package, so we wouldn't have to worry about how do we put all of those pieces together anymore. We would like to extend a huge thank you to our instructors through the phases, especially Sunny, who's seen us all the way from the start, all the way to the end here. They've been really helpful and really supportive while we took on this project. We will be setting up two laptops at the end of presentations today, so you guys have the opportunity to play with the app a little bit. And now we'd like to open the floor to questions. Deb.
I noticed in things like pressing the buttons, you're mostly focusing on finger presses. Are any parts of the hand able to interact with it, or is it limited to just the fingertips?
You can use any part of your hand. It doesn't have to just be your fingertips. That's just one of the easier ways to get it to respond a little bit better. RJ.
What are the hardware requirements for the user? What do they have to buy? Anything special?
The controller. With your controller, and you can use your Mac. And then if the Leap controller, when you plug it in, does walk you through the installation process, but aside from that, there's no special hardware.
How much does that cost?
$90. Jacob.
I'm just curious, in your research, did you find, because this makes a lot of sense, do you know if rehab centers are using virtual reality or anything like that yet, or is this completely new?
There have been some, studies that we found where people are trying to implement things like virtual reality into rehabilitation, but nothing that seems quite mainstream yet.
Do you have any difficulties using the software development kit that you provided? Was that a challenge? Or?
Yeah, there is quite a learning curve to get that. Because you are rendering, you're trying to combine the two technologies, LeapJS and 3JS. So learning that, both libraries were new to us, so trying to get those together took us some time. Yeah.
So you mentioned Unity. Why didn't you go that route to use it? Was it different than was it harder to use, or was it a stress challenge later on?
Yeah, so Unity would be more of a stretch. Unity uses a different language than what we've been taught, what we've used before. Unity uses C#, and that seemed like a little insurmountable for the time period that we had.
Can you use a VR headset?
Yeah.
Yes, there are ways to easily adapt this from your desktop to a VR headset. Yes.
Do you have any plans to introduce this to any rehab centers as a possible
yes.
step forward?
Yep, that's my plan. But we need to finish this bit first.
Any other questions?
You mentioned you wanted to finish the game first, is that what you said?
Yeah.
What do you envision? What is finishing?
First thing I would say, we need more content in this game,
more kinds of games to practice your fingers of different kinds of games. And I think I want to use Unity, since Unity provides you with a lot of tools. It's a really powerful engine. So you can make the user interface really pretty and all those effects. So, yeah. That's
question. Do you ever look into what's it, holographic projection?
Yeah,
it's something new now. It's actually pretty cool. Like, it's kind of like Iron Man kind of type of thing.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it will like hologram like the objects that you have in there, and then you just
you need
the
glasses for that.
Oh yeah. It sounds pretty cool.
I think it can do something like that, but you need glasses
and you need
the Unity for that.
Mm.
Thank you so much. All right, let's give another round of applause to VHab. So, our next project utilizes a little bit of artificial intelligence, a little bit of natural language processing, a little bit of fitness management, and lots of really hilarious, funny cat gifs. So let's hear it for Rhonda.
Good afternoon, everyone. We are Rhonda. My name is Felix, and my team members are Emily, Gibral, and Nadav. Before we start, I would like to take a moment to thank our teachers, Sunny and Phil, and all the other teachers at DBC who helped us make this web app from scratch, which is really amazing. So the main question is, who is Rhonda? Rhonda is a virtual personal assistant who will help you schedule your life and make your life more easy and more fun. So it will schedule your life, like, because in DBC the whole team didn't find the time to eat healthy, to find time to exercise, and even finding a new show to binge watch proved to be a real challenge for us. So we thought by ourselves, why don't we just create an app that does everything for us? Yes. So what can Rhonda do for you? The main functionality of Rhonda is to schedule things in your agenda. So it can give you healthy recipes. To cook, it can give you exercises based on your free time of the day, and it can also set random meetings for you at the time and the place as which you want. To make Rhonda seem human-like and like an actual human you're talking to, not just a robot, we needed a strong backend API that has machine learning. So we looked into a lot of options. There's a lot of stuff out there, but the one we picked was API.ai. The main reason we picked this one is because its software becomes smarter when people use it. So it will recognize words and patterns that it didn't recognize before without us even interacting with it. So the more people who would use Rhonda, the smarter it would become. And to make our bot have a lot of functionalities, we use a bunch of APIs, but we will go into that later. For now, I would just like to let Emily give you a presentation of some functionalities that Rhonda has.
All right, so here's our main page. Nadav, if you scroll down a little. So here are just the basic assets of Rhonda, like Felix was just saying, basically scheduling, health, events, scheduling events, seeing if there are events near you, and just a fun aspect as well. So if we scroll up and click get started. So we are already logged in, but it usually will ask you to log in through your Google email and password. For now, let's just say hello back to Rhonda. And we can say that my name is Emily. And so to start, let's just see how much free time I have today. So we can ask Rhonda, do I have any free time today? Okay, I have 9 hours free. That means I have no excuse not to exercise, so I should probably ask Rhonda for an exercise, see what she says. Okay, that run is way too long. I can barely run 3 miles, so I'm going to say I'm too lazy for that. I don't want to do that. Okay, so she's a little attitude, but I think 6 miles sounds a little better. I'll set that one to my calendar so I don't forget. And let's now check my Google Calendar and see if it posted. And it did. So now I can go back and check that. And while we're on the health track, let's say I just became a vegetarian. I have no idea what to cook, so I'm going to ask Rhonda for some vegetarian meal options. Okay, mini cheesecake. I don't really like cheesecake, so I'm going to say next recipe, see what we have. And, okay, melty onion toast, I guess I'll try that. So if we click more info, I can just save that in a tab for later, and I'll go back to that. So now I'm done with DBC, I have all this time on my hands, I can finally binge watch shows again. So I think my friends have been watching The Affair, so I'm going to ask Rhonda what The Affair is about. Sounds good. All right. Pretty good show. So I'll probably forget when it's on, so Rhonda can help me with that. I'll just plug it into my calendar that I'll watch the show at 10 p.m. And let's just check the calendar. And there it is. Awesome. Okay, and so another thing I've been just wanting to do, I wanted to go to a rap concert in New York City, so let's see if Rhonda knows of any rap concerts. This one takes a while. I think it's a big deal. Okay. Poetry and percussion. I think I'll try it out, so I'll put that on my calendar as well. And the last thing I want to ask Rhonda, like Sunny was saying, I want to see a cat really badly. So I'll ask her for one of those. And my friend Gibral is obsessed with cats. And loves when we send him these gifts, so I'm going to text him a gift. Alright. Oh, and also, if you are ever using Rhonda and you are a little confused, you say a command that might not get a response, Rhonda will say, I didn't understand this, go to documentation, and you can just click documentation in the nav bar, and it's pretty much examples of what you can say, what you can't say.
Alright, it looks like I got my cat gift, so that's very nice. So the next thing we want to talk about is some of the APIs that we use. Now, we use 11 APIs, which is a lot. Okay. Alright. So yeah, we use 11 APIs. I'm gonna start talking about the Google Authentication API. Now, the reason why we need that is that we need to be able to access the different resources that Google has. So we need to be able to talk to Google's servers. Now, to make this work, what we did was we send the username and password to the Google servers and they send us back a token. Now, every time that we need to access one of the resources, we send that token and Google knows who the user is, and we can access their information. Now, the next one I'm going to talk about is Google Calendar. Now, for the Google Calendar, there were two things that we needed to get. We needed to get the free time, and we also need to be able to set an event. Now, the free time algorithm, it took a little bit of working out, trying to get all the formats together. And the set event was pretty cool, just because we were able to use two APIs at one time. So say with Eventful, you're able to get information from Eventful, to get the description, and also get the date and time, and you can send that over to Google. The next API is the TVDB. With this, we send the name of the show to the database, and we can get back a bunch of information about the start time, the ratings for the show, and just different information about the TVDB. We can also set that on the calendar. For the next API is the Meetup API. We integrated with Meetup, so if you want to go to a meetup, say for health, you can type that in, type in where you are and the time, and it'll give you recommendations for the meetups. And then you can also set that on your calendar. So the next one was Marvel. That was more fun. If you like comic book characters like I do, you know, Marvel APIs for you. You put in the character you want to know about, and it gives you a brief description and also gives you a URL. Let's talk more about the APIs that we used. Pass it over to Emily.
All right, so Spoonacular is the API for our recipes. We just got a random recipe by basically any food name or any type of food, so that spoke to the API AI. And the next one is Twilio, which was really cool. It's awesome we got to be able to have Rhonda actually send a text message. So we had Twilio speak to Rhonda, which spoke to the GIF, which was pretty cool. And the GIF API, obviously, that's where the GIFs come from. That was our favorite, and we played around with it a lot. And Eventful is pretty similar to the meetup. It pretty much gives you any event by the date, zip code. You can enter in like an art museum or a food event, pretty much anything in your area. And the weather we didn't show today, but that one shows you your local weather by zip code and the daily.
We use the following technologies while building a project, and Rails is our backend and React is our frontend. And what React enables us is to update portions of the page you're viewing without refreshing the whole web page, which drastically improves the user experience.
So as you saw before, we use a lot of APIs and they had to interact with each other. The way we set up our files in the beginning was that we had one big controller file where everything happens. The controller file, so the user put in the text, it went to the API, AI API in the cloud, and then it spit out the data to a controller file. Then the controller file performed all the logic onto it, selected which API to use, and also produced the output. So it was responsible for everything, so that wasn't a great thing to do.
Yeah, it really was easier when we first started at the beginning, because we didn't have a lot of API, so we didn't think too much about the architecture. But as it got bigger, we realized it was harder to debug if everything was in one file. And also, it was just harder to grow it.
Yeah, so we decided to refactor everything, like every single file we had, because we thought about what if we wanted to add 20 more features or 20 more APIs, would this be feasible with the previous infrastructure? The simple answer was that it probably just never would have been. We'd have so many bugs and so many files, just so many different definitions in one file, it's just not a good thing to do. So we refactored it in this way. The user still sends the input to the API and still sends it to the controller file. But this time around, the controller file only has one responsibility. It sends the data toward API distributor model, and this model recognizes the action and then decides which API it has to use. So it sends the data to the corresponding API, and this is where all the magic happens. So this API module takes the data from the API database and performs the logic and the algorithms onto it, and then sends out the response. So we send the response to our last module, which is the messagizer module. It's responsible for formatting our output in a standardized way so that our front end can actually recognize everything. So you might be asking, what's the main advantage of this new infrastructure? The main point is scalability and durability. Let's say if you wanted to add someone to our team, or if you wanted to add 50 new features, or even just debug a small thing, we only have to look at the middle part. We just look into one file. Our controller file, or API distributor file, and our messagizer file will always mean the same thing, even if we add like a million new features. So if we add new features, our other app will never break. It's really robust. And we believe that this is very important for a virtual assistant, because the user nowadays does not want to be limited in virtual in artificial intelligence. So they want new capabilities of our API, and we believe that with this architecture, we can actually go into the needs of the user. So with much further ado, I would like to let you try out our app and have some fun with it. If there are any questions, we welcome you to ask them to us. So the way we have our Twilio account is, if you have a free number, you can only send to verified numbers. So you have to send a text to the person you want to text to, and they give you a code, and then we have to add it to our Twilio account. So for now, it's just all preset because we didn't want to pay for it. But it would be easy for us to just sync our Google Calendar group because we have the Google token.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yes?
An app like this, I
want this on my phone. Is it capable to be on my phone right now?
It is capable. I've tried it out on my phone. It works just if you're logged in on Google on your phone. Because if not, there might be some issues with the login on your phone. But if you have like Gmail app on your phone, you can use it in exactly the same way as this.
Yeah, you can open it in Safari or whatever. It's just not like a mobile app.
Do you have any plans to make like voice recognition? It seems like it'd be something that would be great to talk to.
Yeah, we that was one of the stretch challenges that we actually wanted to do. It's not that hard to put in voice recognition and make it talk to the API and even get like voice responses back, but we wanted to focus first on the text input and then, you know, maybe on the voice, but we didn't have time for that. But it's definitely possible.
I noticed that you didn't actually tell it to look for vegetarian recipes. Was that something that you set in your user registration that happened before the presentation?
How do you mean?
Because Emily
like we
said...
We wrote, I want to cook a vegetarian meal.
Yeah.
So the API AI, you set these things called intents.
Right.
And it knew recipe to go to the Spoonacular API. Like it connected it. It's smart enough to know that. So we could have wrote, I want a recipe of chicken, but we would have had to put that in the intent. We could probably show you guys the website.
So the default would be vegetarian?
Yeah, the vegetarian is what it's grabbing. And recipe. If you say next recipe, it gives the next recipe. If you say next gift, it attaches you know, with that one to it. It's just how the API AI works. That's pretty much it.
And we're really focused on trying to get healthy options. So that was kind of one of the main purposes of this, trying to get healthy during DBC, because, you know, that was,
Roman?
Yeah,
Roman
Gibral, before
No, we actually don't retain any user information once you log out, never existed. It's kind of like part of the reason why we chose to use the Google authentication rather than implementing our own local one.
You guys said you guys use machine learning API, right? Like,
yes.
To learn from like the mistakes and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, how are they doing that?
So the way it works is, after like the last couple of days, we tested a lot. So it started to recognize intents that you did not create. For example, the vegetarian meal one. If we type in, if you set chicken, tomatoes, and stuff, 20 options, and we test it out all the time, it will recognize even food that we didn't set in because it's smart enough. And you can go into the API console and correct mistakes of users and set up as intent. So it's like it needs a little bit of user input, like to make people make comments and stuff, but it learns a lot by itself. Alexandra?
Did you consider at any point setting up a sort of introduction process for this, for the user to put in their own, sort of, without knowing it, programming their own intent?
I don't believe that is possible with the machine learning API we use, because this is like you have an administrator, so the user can't really set anything up. So we set everything up, and there's not really anything that the user can do except use our app and use everything that we have done. Yes. Well, the way we made our architecture, it would be really easy to just add everything we wanted to. Like, one feature that we would love to add is that we let, like, for example, you say, do I have any meetings today? Rhonda checks your email, looks for the word meeting, and then gives you back the responses. If you say, set this meeting, it will set the meeting in the calendar and set it to the Gmail account. That was something we were working on, but we didn't have the time to finish because we were more focused on refactoring our code and making it flexible for the future. So it's definitely, if we want to, we can definitely add a lot of features.
Time for one more question.
Yes, Kevin?
Why the name Rhonda?
Because we were practicing our, I think it was, we made Facebook in phase 3, and Sunny was trying to give us an example, and literally was like, here's Rhonda and here's John, and it just, we liked the name Rhonda. Yeah, we were gonna play it when we walked up.
All right, thanks so much. Okay, guys. Who hates public speaking. I do. I hate being up here. I'm just kidding. So our next group uses the most cutting-edge speech-to-text and sentiment analysis technologies to help you be a better public speaker. So let's hear it for Articulate.
First off, shout out to all the other groups that had to come up here.
Yeah.
Yeah, good job.
And Sunny. And all of
us. And Sunny.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hello. My name is Alex. These are my team members, Mark, Patrick, and Alexandra, and we are Articulate. So, as many of you know, public speaking can be difficult. It can be really stressful. And some of the things that people feel when they're about to speak are things like rapid heart rate, shaky voice, sweaty palms. And for me personally, it's something that I've struggled with. So me and my team set out to create an app that could allow you to practice your speaking, receive personalized feedback, and practice in a judgment-free zone in the privacy of your own home. So users can simply speak into the microphone on their computer or laptop and get an in-depth analysis based on the big five personality types that Watson provides to get information on emotional output, speaking rate, receive information on keywords or phrases that they use, and even filler words that might be muddying their message. So if you're unsure of your message that you're trying to send or just need to practice, you can run it by us. The technologies we use are also perfectly suited for papers and documents. So if you're unsure of how that email to your boss might come across, run it through our text analyzer for the most up-to-date and personalized feedback. And now I will pass it off to Mark, who will give a brief demonstration on how our app works.
Cool. Thanks, man. Actually, before I begin, I also just want to, I think on behalf of all of us, just say thank you, Alex, for sharing your vision with us and letting us be a part of it. Can everyone see in the back? Is it hard to see, or...? Cool. Great. So one of the things that we talked about and we all felt really passionate about is that we wanted this to be like a utility for everyone, regardless of whether you're logged in or logged out. So right now you can see like we're not logged in, but lucky for us, we can still record and get our results. So my teammate Alexandra came up with a inspiring and original speech for us that she's going to demonstrate.
Yeah, I'll just jump right in. Good morning. In less than an hour, aircraft from here will join others from around the world, and you will be launching the largest aerial battle in this history of mankind. Mankind. That word should have new meaning today. We can't be consumed by our petty differences anymore. We will be united in our common interests. Perhaps it is fate that today is the 4th of July. And you will once again be fighting for our freedom, not from tyranny, oppression, or persecution, but from annihilation. We're fighting for our right to live, to exist. And should we win the day, the 4th of July will no longer be known in the as an American holiday, but as the day when the world declared in one voice, we will not go quietly into the night, we will not vanish without a fight, we're going to live on, we're going to survive. Today, we celebrate our Independence Day. Just came up with that one.
You have a lot for it to think about.
Cool.
Wow.
So yeah, as you can see, our app produced a bunch of data, and I'm just going to quickly walk you through it from the user standpoint. So the first thing you're seeing at the top where it says feedback is something that we added. It's a utility that tells you how essentially good your speech was and how it could come across. So Alex, great job. Your word count is great. Speech was fine. No filler words, always a plus. And yeah, you can come across as being cynical, which is kind of, I mean, considering the context of the speech. Not a very fairly accurate assessment. So if you go down on the right-hand side, you'll see something called hierarchy. So that's basically the API's best guess of what speech is essentially about. And I would say it's relatively spot on, considering it says unrest in war. Awesome. To the left of that, you'll see something called keywords, and that is what the API essentially thinks your speech is about, in a sense. So you'd see the largest aerial battle, relatively on point again. Cool. We didn't have any filler words. And then the last but not least, we talked about what would be the best way to... So our API gives us a ton of data. We want to think of the best way to graph it and make it nice, essentially. So we came up with a bubble chart that uses, or that essentially graphs the emotional data. So if you hover over one of these, it'll tell you the emotional range, the conscientiousness, and the sadness of the speech, and it gives you a competency value. Your emotional range was on point, Alexandra. You can toggle through charts, so on and so forth. That was so good that I think we should register with the site because I think it's deserved it.
We will register.
I'll go by Alice Cooper.
Alice Cooper is definitely a good choice.
So that's how we'll sign in. A simple password.
Great. And now you can see there's access to this history tab. Yeah. Cool. So. We have a very special user that we have prepared, correct?
These two.
Yeah, so we didn't want to waste your time and go through a little more, because we have like a user that's been very active. Let's see.
Charles Barkley.
We decided to use Charles Barkley. So a cool thing about our app is that we graph historical averages, or we don't graph it, but sorry, we collect historical averages. So let's say there's 20 speeches, right? Every single one of these values is an amalgamation of an average of, let's say, anger or, So Charles Barkley, his social tone, very high. Not bad. Openness, he's very open. And I think we pulled this from Twitter, so it's very accurate assessment.
Can you look at one of his posts?
Yeah, you'll notice something too. We have the opportunity to put text in our speech, so instead of just talking into it, you can just submit a paragraph or whatever. And you'll notice the results are different. There's no words per minute, there's no time duration, it's just a straight up analysis of your text. That's the main user functionality. I'm gonna pass it off to Alexandra to talk about tech.
Thank you, Mark. So when you go to our site originally, whether you log on or not, if you choose to make a speech rather than directly input text, your speech is then sent to the Google Web Speech API, which then parses that speech into plain text and sends it back to our server. We then, in turn, send that to Watson, where it's analyzed by both the Alchemy Language API and the Tone Analysis API. And as Mark mentioned before, you do get a lot of information back, whether or not how much you choose to use and everything, and what was most important to us was user friendliness. So when we pass it back to the user, we try to make it colorful and visually alluring and easy to understand. We also do some of our own calculations to get adjectives and things that are just a little bit more personalized to the user. As it said, I sounded cautious and cynical. I wouldn't necessarily disagree. Thank you. It might also describe you as boisterous and a few other averages. Now, that was the journey of the data itself, and to talk about our own personal journey through this project, this is Patrick.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of our workflow and some of the challenges we faced throughout the course of the project. Overall, I think we'd all agree that we kept each other pretty balanced throughout the course of the project, didn't run into any like huge group dynamic issues, fortunately. And I think something that helped us with that was using GitHub issues instead of a Trello, which we had used previously, or a Scrum board. It allowed us to keep track of bugs or problems that came up as they came up in the context of our project. And it also allowed us to set milestones for when we wanted particular features done. It allowed us to assign people to those features, and when they got closed out, say, here's where this got closed out. So it just serves as a very good log for the project too, for anyone who might want to take it and do more with it. They can see what was done when. And it was a way to keep, for us to keep each other accountable, and also to, if anyone had free time, they could just jump in and fix something that was not working. So that worked out well for us. But it wasn't all so smooth and easy. We did have a couple hurdles, especially in the beginning. Kind of the main core functionality that we wanted from this app was the ability to speak to the browser, have it get some text, and then interpret that text. And in the beginning, in looking what was available, Watson has a speech-to-text API that's very useful. We tried to do that. We originally were thinking of having an audio component where you'd talk, the audio would record, and then maybe as you play back the audio in the browser, you get results. Or maybe as you talk to the browser, that audio is streaming to the API, interpreting it, and then coming back to our server.
Yeah. And so with the text-to-speech, the speech-to-text, we really had a struggle getting that started. And it was really getting on the back end, sort of, we were getting on our front end these sort of blobs that we didn't know how to take that data from our server and then send it to the Watson API to actually get back text. And so we decided as a group to sort of, after 2 days really of struggling with this, we knew we had to come up with something else because we weren't really getting anything done. We were still in that research phase. And we decided to go with the web speech API that Patrick sort of looked into, and I thought that, wow, yeah, this seems very straightforward. And we decided to go in that route. And within, 4 or 5 hours on Saturday morning, we had it going, and it was like, now we can actually start building out our site. So that's what really got us. That was the really big hurdle for us.
Yeah. Like you said, once we got over that, we really could focus on making the site we wanted to. But I think we'd all still consider it a stretch goal to have some kind of recorded audio component or some kind of live feedback at some point. But we had a lot of features we wanted to add, so we had to prioritize. Thanks to Alex for helping us with that.
Thank you, Patrick. I'd just like to take a minute to thank Sunny and the staff at DBC for everything they did and helping us, providing a great support system. I'd also like to take some time to thank my team. I can't believe how much time we spent working on this together. I couldn't have asked for a better team, and we will be having a computer set up in the back to test our app. We are also up on articulately.herokuapp.com, and our motto is speak clearly, speak confidently, articulate. And that's our presentation. I'd like to open up the floor to any questions.
Question. In terms of the feedback that it is providing, I'm thinking more so on the side, along the lines of gender, right? So like when women are confident, they're seen as aggressive. When a guy is confident, he's seen as confident, right? And so wondering the feedback that your app gives back, is it conscious and mindful of those things when given feedback, or is there no way to actually, manage that type of thing?
It would be something that might be possible to manage. It would require the user to probably specify gender, as it does only take in text. So it's not actually reading like cadence or tone. It's just parsing that into text, and then the interpretations come from the text itself. But you will get different kinds of feedback based on the averages. So if you have a profile and most of your speeches register low in confidence or low in anger, if you do a speech that's particularly confident or particularly angry on the other side, it'll flag that and let you know this, for you, reads this way.
You said that the Alchemy API gives you a wealth of information. Is there anything that you decided not to use at all or yet? And if so, what was it?
There were a few parts of both APIs that we didn't get a chance to integrate. We did want to work with more charts, but there was kind of a time constraint. We were thinking about using the sentiment analysis that it gives you on keywords, which include like positive and negative results. And we were thinking about displaying that in either some sort of bar chart or some sort of gradiated like bar where the keywords are kind of sliders along it. But we didn't get a chance to implement that. That's kind of like a stretch goal.
There were also certain factors of what Alchemy language gives back that in our initial research were coming back not accurate enough for us to feel comfortable sharing with the user just yet. Watson is still pretty new, and as I understand, it learns as it goes, much like our app does. So what we really wanted, though, was to keep the feedback as, like we learn at DBC, actionable, specific, kind, and accurate.
Yes, yes in the back.
Will it account for mispronunciation or grammar?
Well, we were looking into grammar API. Alex, do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I swiped that for a good part of the morning, and also sent Phil on it to no avail. Unfortunately, natural language processors being what they are, and grammar and language being as constantly evolving as it is very difficult to implement a grammar checker for something like this. We figure most people on their personal computer will probably have a text editing software that will give them spelling mistakes and things like that. But we definitely would consider it a stretch goal if we could find the resource that would give us information, again, that's concise and accurate enough for us to feel comfortable presenting it to a user.
Yeah. I also think with the web speech API we're using, it doesn't really give punctuation. It just kind of parses the speech into text. But for like a text analysis standpoint, I could see it being a lot simpler to implement with that because you already have sort of the basic structure of sentences and everything. So, any other questions? Great.
Thank you. Awesome.
Hey guys, can you believe it? That took them all 1 week for each of those projects. So that concludes our demo. I'd invite you guys to please stick around. At about 4:30, we're going to have our graduation ceremony to send off the Jackrabbits into the world. Thanks, guys.